about the week from who you've been. Can you win this war you're in? Is your point laborious, or will you rise victorious? Take it or break it. Take it or break it.
Welcome to Take It or Break It, the sports takes game show of your dreams, your nightmares. I'm your host, Corbin Smith. It's the Super Bowl preview edition, baby. And I went around and I asked every football writer I knew, Pellucci, Spike Friedman. That's it. Those are the two guys I asked. And Pellucci couldn't do it because he's working on something. And Spike has not responded to me. Have you guys seen him at all? I'm worried.
Have you heard from him since the Seahawks defeat in their playoff game?
No, I don't think I. You think he might be on a weeks-long bender?
I mean, or like he was just like, I'm done with sports. I'm grad school only now, guys.
Yeah, I guess he's in grad school, so he's probably.
What is Spike studying?
Urban, the same thing Lewis is.
Lewis Keane?
Yeah.
That's a weird that draws in. Lewis Keane, the bad boy of USC.
Spike got into it. I'll ask you why you said that in a second. But Spike got into it because he got into the activism angle of the Los Angeles Olympics, which is to say, kind of opposing it.
Sure.
And I think that his interest in that sort of dovetailed in him just throwing up his hands and getting a graduate degree, if I recall. Hopefully Spike doesn't feel misrepresented by this, but anyway. I ran plumb out of football writers, and so instead, I've gone to America's favorite basketball podcasters from Roundball Rock. It's Joey Devine.
Hi. It's me, Joey Devine.
You didn't do the trademark
one. Host of Roundball Rock. And, hi, that's what you want?
Yeah, I didn't want it, but like when you did it, I was like, when I first started listening to Roundball Rock, and it started with the SNL parody, and also Joey going hi.
You hated it.
Oh yeah, for like a second, I was like, what is this dog shit? And now it's my favorite basketball podcast.
Yeah, well, we can't stop doing the Don Pardo thing either.
I know. Look, I know. I've grown to love it, and I've grown to love Hi because I love Joey.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks.
We do.
I forget why that started. It was like a joke.
It was a joke you did, and then like one of our very first reader communications called it like your catchphrase.
Oh right, yeah.
And
yeah.
So then, but we were only like five.
This
or
is
six
a real. This
in
is a real Will. This is a real Wilms getting bought too much sludge situation, I think.
But yeah, that's why I'm stuck saying that all the time now, because I did it as a joke one time because Dave used to host. And Dave introduced me, and I was just like, hi.
No.
Anyway, yeah.
No, but you know, but people, they'll send Wilms messages that says, hey, we're getting sludge. And he'll be like, I don't know if I can tonight. And they'll be like, you're violating the brand. And the next thing you know, he's
Wilms is drunk again.
Yeah, he's face down in a bucket of sludge.
I was going to say it's actually more like the fact that his name is actually Wilmes.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
You think it's like a joke?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
I now will mention him in the apartment, and I'll say, Wilm said this, and my girlfriend will say, his name is Wilmes. Like,
I don't know. Look,
why don't you be respectful?
It is straight up canon that I don't mention the thing you're talking about on this show. So.
It's also very funny that the man himself is like, I don't care.
Yeah, he doesn't care. Yeah. I had known him for a year before I might have heard something that resembles the thing that you guys might be saying right now. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, our other guest is Sean Keane, also of Roundball Rock, who was also on Take It or Break It last week. And I didn't quite realize it until I asked him. And I was like, ugh.
Yeah. But I haven't come on to talk about football. And I was a... I've written about football before.
Yeah, Sean actually watches football.
I had like a year and a half long column where I would review all the referee calls.
Uh-huh.
But it was not very serious at all.
Wait, so was it a high concept thing, or did they hire you to do a straight thing and you did a high concept thing?
Both. Okay. I think they hired me to do it once, and then I started doing it for basketball and football when they realized I just used it as like a jumping off point to make fun of the games, like, because in football it's like this, usually there are not that many super crucial calls as much as fan bases like to say it, but
please, fan bases and also Louisiana Senators.
That's right. That card stunt, incredible. Anyway, yeah. So I had to.
The government was still shut down at that point, right? That's true.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, it was.
Okay. Anyway, I'm glad New Orleans lost. Fuck them. I don't. You know. I'm starting to develop like a hardened, jaded anti-New Orleans. I just will always root against New Orleans.
It's oh, so like, you want Anthony Davis to shit on them on his way out?
Yeah, fuck him. He shouldn't have a team. It doesn't make any sense.
Is it because you hate the television show Tremé?
Look, Tremé doesn't help.
You know what? Here's what I'm saying. If the Pelicans were truly ever going to draw, have we ever seen actor Nicolas Cage in the stands at their games?
No.
Or Dr. John.
Yeah, well, Dr. John at least is old.
But if you can't get Dr. John to something in New Orleans, you're doing something wrong.
Wait,
did he play at the All-Star game?
Does Cage go to stuff in New Orleans, or does he just...
He lives there.
...lounge around in mansions?
I mean, he makes 5 action movies a year that are all set there.
And I believe he is in those parades sometimes.
Like
the Mardi Gras parades.
Mardi Gras parades?
Yeah, where he's like also the king of Mardi Gras or whatever.
He's also the junior senator from Louisiana now.
Yeah, that's true.
Dr. John did do the halftime show.
Well, he was at
he
the
and
right
trombone
place.
Shorty.
Yeah, he was in the right place at the wrong time. Thank you for stepping on my joke, Sean.
Sorry, I saw trombone shorty and I felt like I had to say it out loud.
Trombone Shorty is a person I only know from All-Star events.
Uh-huh.
I think I've seen him at the Super Bowl and also at the NBA All-Star game, and both times I was like, I've never heard of this person in my entire life.
Yeah, cause
doesn't it sound like a mean insult for like a child?
It's fucking Trombone Shorty over here. I don't even know what that would be.
Anyway, I'm pro New Orleans. I don't know why I'm shitting on New Orleans so much.
I just think it's goofy.
Yeah, it's probably Tremé though.
Yeah, doesn't help certainly. Anyway, so hey guys, what's up? Good to talk to you. Always a pleasure, Joey, Sean. You know. What's up? What's happening? You know, all right, we're done with this part. All right, here's our game today. All right, we're doing a special.
Corbin, what do you think about the trade?
Which
the
one?
Big the trade today.
Porzingis trade.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I forgot. Knicks probably shouldn't have done that. I think that's the most I can think about it. We're gonna have Bob on next week, so I'd suspect we'll get an earful about it. But like,
Bob is going like straight process trusting about it.
Yeah, I don't. You know what? You know what else I kind of think about it though.
What?
Why sit around and bleed? Just yank the knife out.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's something. spiritually admirable about it, even if maybe they should have put a little bit more back into finding a better suitor. You know?
The Knicks?
Yeah.
Yeah, that they made the trade 4 minutes after it leaked.
But
they
no, were shopping him.
That's not what happened, though.
They're straight up just blaming Porzingis to get off of this. Like, one of the Dallas reporters, I forget who, before the Knicks went full Kristaps blame, like right when the trade went through, was like, hey, the Dallas and the Knicks were talking about this Wednesday night.
Oh, damn.
They were definitely shopping him all week. And then Kristaps heard and then went in and was like, okay, really trade me, dicks.
No, I mean, it was just very funny to see Woj tweeting like, oh, these five teams all might have interest. And then like 30 seconds later being like, the trade's actually complete. And awaiting league approval. Also, those guys were clearly talking about Dennis Smith Jr. like a month ago.
Right.
Well, yeah. How could you not? You know?
Yeah.
Anyway, I don't want to root for Dallas for personal reasons. And also because I hate Mark Cuban.
What's your personal reason? Oh, because of the We Believe?
Grantland Jr. Not big on Grantland.
Oh.
Oh, just because you don't like Grantland?
Yeah, Bill Simmons was on his podcast today saying Haralabob deserves executive of the year.
Why?
As if that's who was making these moves, because they hired him this summer.
He does. And Haralabob, right?
And Haralabob was like, "Hey, try to get Porzingis," and they were like, "Whoa, wait, you think that guy might be good?
Wow, you think that?"
"Hey, you should draft."
You know what?
Mo Bamba.
I'm gonna let Bill have this one. Because whatever, Haralabob's his pal. He just wants to say something nice about his pal Haralabob.
But you know what? I'm gonna defend my pal Don Nelson Sr. here, because these are two straight up Don Nelson trades, and his son is the one who made them.
Yeah, I guess that's fair.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah, very impulsive. Tons of players.
Do you think that after
someone
he saw
from
this,
a Baltic Republic comes back,
yeah. and there's like a huge chance it blows up in a year and a half? Yes, these are definitely a Don Nelson moves.
Mm-hmm. Wait, why would it blow up? Why wouldn't they re-sign Porzingis?
Porzingis said today, right after the trade, that he's informing Dallas he's going to sign the qualifying offer.
I know, but these guys, like, everybody. Just
wait,
blew
why is Porzingis
so
going to sign the qualifying offer?
His agent is terrible, apparently. Like, if there's like one guy who should just sign that guaranteed max,
what the fuck is he doing? That doesn't make any sense.
Also, where does he want to go?
Yeah. Does he? Oh, he doesn't want to go to a top shelf organization that goes out of their way to invest in medical stuff and training and literally everything that he's going to need as he gets older.
Hold on, though. Let's be fair to the Dallas Mavericks. They're not exactly a top-shelf organization, considering there was thousands of years of sexual harassment going on.
Aside from that, I apologize.
You think Porzingis cares about that, though? The only thing I can think is if he's like, look, I miss Latvia. Couldn't I play in Minnesota, where like a weird, cranky old man pulls all the strings, it's ice cold all the time, and the whole organization is just based on pitting people against each other all the time. It's like, that's what I remember
from
home.
Minnesota needs to invest in?
Who?
Mark Jackson.
No, the Lakers are going to.
Oh, yeah, but Minnesota...
That's going to be the funniest shit in the world, dude.
Did you listen to my last episode I did with John? I think that they're hiring Mark Jackson because Mark Jackson would take out Magic and exhaust himself enough so that he would also get fired so that LeBron couldn't put an even bigger toady in. I think that this is just a play for LeBron to collect more power.
Well, yeah, because Mark Jackson's a clutch, is represented by clutch, so...
Yeah, but he's also a plotter, you know?
No, and but what like, I believe... that LeBron will actually, because he is an investor in Clutch Sports, will actually make money off of Mark Jackson being hired by the Lakers.
What if
you know what I'm saying, Corbin?
Well, here's, yeah, I get here's it. My, yeah. All right.
Can I throw out a theory here? Mark yes. Jackson signs for a relatively low annual salary, but giant punitive penalty for a firing.
Ron James forces his firing
just to collect on that clutch commission.
Oh shit. Then the next thing you know, Mark's in there fucking worming around. He gets Palenka fired. He destroys Magic's reputation. Just LeBron just gets to step in the fucking power vacuum, dude.
I mean, he already has one GM, right?
Look,
it's the Lakers have two GMs in the league, right? James Jones and Rob Palenka.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Palenka wasn't a clutch client, a clutch.
I think he's a Lakers GM.
Yes, he is. Yeah.
Hey, he was Kobe's dirtbag agent.
Yeah.
Oh, and Booster's agent.
But yeah, imagine how funny it's gonna be, guys, when Anthony Davis and LeBron James are on the Lakers and they're being coached by Mark Jackson.
Oh yeah, it'd be hilarious. It'd be so funny. Do you think that LeBron is going to yell at Mark Jackson on the court?
Yeah, of course.
Do you think he's going, like, do you think he's going to do things to, like, let everybody in the world know that he's daddy?
I think it'll happen maybe even at the introductory press conference. like LeBron will, like, pat him on the head or something.
There will for sure be some Instagram post by some player where it's like whichever one young guy is back is at Mark Jackson's mega church and LeBron and Anthony Davis are not there. And it'll be like, we had Sunday services with Coach. And it'll just be all the bench players.
Well, I mean, in fairness, LeBron and AD will be busy, you know, making their weekly sacrifice to Satan.
Yeah. A little hard to call Rich Paul Satan.
Yeah. Zing, got him.
Yeah.
Anyway, okay. So this is our game. Super Bowl. This is our game this week, and in anticipation of the upcoming Superb Owl. I have collected pictures of various players from the Los Angeles Rams and the New England Patriots. For those who don't know, Joey and Sean are entertainment industry professionals. Is that safe to say?
Yeah, that is true.
It's a stretch, but yeah.
And they have they have it in their hearts, their minds, and their fingers to craft a television pilot,
mm-hmm.
out of basically nothing. And so what I'm going to do is we've got our Skype window open here, and I'm going to send them pictures of players, and they are going to separately devise a pilot that will devise a television show that will feature this player in the lead. And I depending on how good it is, I will give them 0 points, 1 point, or 3 points.
Mm-hmm.
Do we all understand?
I'm going to try and shoot the moon.
Oh, shit.
Oh, shit. Oh, fuck. All right.
Negative threes across the board. Yes, I understand. Joey.
Keane, do you understand?
Sean.
All right. Here we go. Second, let me. Our first player is Patrick Chung from the New England Patriots. Let's describe this fellow a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
He's got a mouth guard,
mm-hmm.
arm tattoos. Looks like he's wearing the number 23, Michael Jordan's number. Of
course.
Is
that why you picked him to send first?
Nah, it was just
23.
Just total coincidence. The sides of his things are shaved, his head.
But he also has sideburns.
But he also does
sideburns.
Yeah, it's actually kind of a weird look in this photo. He has sideburns, and then there's a space, and then there's a goatee, and he has sideburns, and there's a space, and there's his hair.
Mm-hmm.
So he has,
and his hair is it's like a fade.
Yeah.
Um.
But there's just like a sideburn just sitting in the middle of his
face. But also, looks like he's crying in this picture.
It does look a little bit like he's crying in this picture. And he has a mouth guard in, which makes it look like he's crying because he's a child and something bad happened to him. He plays strong safety for the Patriots.
He is Chinese Jamaican.
Oh, thank you. And so
his mom is a reggae artist, in fact.
Oh, is that true?
Mm-hmm.
Did you know that off the top of your head, or are you looking it up?
Yeah, because I used to watch football games with my friend Annie Chung, and she had a Patrick Chung jersey because it was like, I mean, it's amazing if you're a Patriots fan, and it was improbable that they would ever have a player named Chung. Mm-hmm. She thought, and she was like, "I got it." Just
because they mostly
this guy's
have,
my favorite player, obviously.
Whites. They only have white players.
That's true. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And now, please pitch me the Patrick Chung pilot. We will start with Joey Devine.
Okay. It's an animated series because he has a very, there's a cartoonish quality to him. I feel like a youthful quality. It's going to be about him growing up with other baby Patriots defense characters.
Uh-huh.
It's called Chungy Babies.
Sorry, it's called Chungy Babies.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Look, not my best work. I'm not getting a lot from this guy. I'm going to be totally honest.
Okay. I like
0 points.
I liked that. That he was a baby and all the other... Yeah, that's 0 points. I tried to give you one, but I just couldn't do it. I mean, I would have given you one, but then you said the phrase, Chungy Babies.
Chungy Babies, that's the problem. Yeah. Admittedly, that's the problem. I know where the problem lies, Corpse.
Okay, all right.
I do like the idea of a baby having the sideburns and the goatee, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Kind of like Bebe's kids. You know what I mean?
No.
You don't know what Bebe's kids
is? Can I be real with you? This is the most how I know Bebe's kids. I'm vaguely familiar with Bebe's kids, I think. But the most I know about it is that in Nintendo Power magazine, when they released an issue with the top 50 Nintendo games of all time, they had a worst games list too, and the Bebe's kids game was number one. It is an infamously bad video game.
It's weird there's a Bebe's Kids.
Very weird that there's a video game of that.
But the reason I brought up Bebe's Kids is I believe a baby is voiced by Tone Loc in Bebe's Kids.
Mm.
You know who Tone Loc is?
The rapper.
Yeah, yeah. Wild there. Slash that guy. Actor. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
He also voices a character in Ferngully the Last Rainforest.
Oh, that's fun.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a lizard of some kind.
Sean, please pitch your Patrick Chung pilot.
Okay, he is in a competitive reality show that's about barbers. And here's how it works. He's the host. This takes place somewhere in the Caribbean, and these are some of the best barbers. They're only really working, not a lot of scissors. It's mostly a razor-based thing. But the trick is they have to smoke a blunt and do 3 shots of rum before attempting their styling, and that's how you end up with a haircut and beard look that Patrick Chung has, and the show is called Getting Faded.
I'm gonna lose this episode.
Oof. That's I'm gonna have to give you 3 points for that one, Sean. I mean, the drugs, you know, logistically the drugs maybe present kind of a problem.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's for Spike TV, I think.
Oh, okay. All right.
And and they must film it in international waters, I think.
Because of the weed? I mean, you can film it on the West Coast. We got weed, you know.
Yeah. Can I change my pitch?
You can't change it, but I mean, I guess if you have another one, I'll hear
it. I do have another idea.
Okay.
It's called Chung v. Chung.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Patrick Chung. It's a competitive weekly series between Patrick Chung, obviously, the strong safety,
obviously,
and former MTV VJ Alexa Chung. And they switch, they like switch lives for a day. You know what I mean? So like Alexa Chung has to play strong safety for a game, and my actual never mind. Did you guys hear the Alexa my parents got me started talking to me?
I thought it was like a woman.
No, it's the Alexa that my parents got me. I know that you do have a girlfriend.
Mm-hmm. But I want you to know that if you didn't, that would have been like sad. If I was like, "Oh, who's that saucy lady?" and you say it's a computer.
And yeah, so you know, Patrick Chung then has to model for Cosmo, because I'm looking it up. Alexa Chung was like, she's the face of Longchamp, whatever that is, some fashion brand.
It's Champion, but everything's a little longer.
Yeah. It's in February 2010, she collaborated with J. Crew's Madewell on a women's wear line. Oh, so yeah, it's like wife swap, but job swap. But it's Chung v. Chung. And there's also judges who decide who did a better job in their Freaky Friday situation.
But she's probably going to die.
Yeah, that's kind of a problem, because she's just a tiny little lady.
No, because I
feel
like...
How much do you think she weighs?
But here's the thing. Mm-hmm. Strong safety, you know, if you don't know how to play strong safety in an NFL game, you can just get out of the way. You know what I mean?
So wait, but then why wouldn't
she's
Alexa...
She's like actively running away.
Why wouldn't Alexa just lose every week?
Because she'll learn to... Tom Brady's magic football powers will teach her how to play. I don't know. I just wanted something better than Chungy Babies.
Well, you unfortunately, I wish you just hadn't repeated Chungy Babies.
Mm-hmm, me too.
Oh, it's crawling around in my blood.
It sounded more like Muppet in my head. You know what I mean? Anyway.
Oh, really? Chungy sounded
and
like
actually,
Muppet?
That honestly would be a good show, because the Patriots also have identical twins in the secondary right now.
Mm-hmm.
So that's like Scooter and Skeeter.
With the Chungy
Jason and Devin McCourty.
It's time to bop a dot on the Chungy show tonight.
It's growing on you. I can tell.
Nope.
And can you imagine like Belichick just like being the Nana character? You just see like the bottom of like a tattered hooded sweatshirt at the top of the screen, and then just like, "Oh, your kids better study the playbook. Stop having adventures."
All right, next one.
I mean, it's growing on me too, man.
It is Los Angeles Rams punter Johnny Hecker. Here we have Mr. Hecker. He's a redheaded fella. He appears to have dachshund arms. He has a red goatee, and in this picture, it looks like he's whistling. So. Give you guys a second to think about this. So big, full lips on this fella. Full lips, I'd say. A lot of.
He's
freckles.
Trying to get us to pitch a show about ass eating.
Yeah.
Oh no, no! I can I? I truly wasn't. I truly was not. I truly was not.
But you can see he does kind of have the chin for it too. Wait, like, what? Look at that beard now. You can't think of anything else, can you, Corbin?
I guess that's fair. Sean Keane, please pitch your Johnny Hecker television program.
Okay, so this is it's a hard-boiled crime show where Johnny plays the lead of a bunch of Christian vigilantes. And they solve a lot of bank robberies, basically. But the key is everything is PG down the middle. Like
everything about this guy is PG.
Yeah. There's like the guys are somehow like robbing banks with like Nerf guns that they've tricked them, and like even all the fighting is like people are just getting caught in nets, or they like slip on a bunch of marbles, and there's like a very pro Christian message, and just like every week it's him and his also devout, you know, clean living people just making the clean town even cleaner. They're really cleaning up the streets, and the title of this show is Hecker High Water.
I've decided that I can award you 2 points now, because I can't give that three. But
and it kind of made you mad. It made you too mad to give three.
To give it three. So, So this is like a nice town. So are they like? I mean, are they robbing like abortion clinics?
No, it's still just that's just like they wouldn't even.
That's not PG enough, dude.
Yeah, and also, these guys are not. No one is having sex in this town.
Okay. Oh wow.
But like somehow there's still an orphanage that they have to save about every third episode.
Uh huh. Uh huh.
But yeah, there's nobody.
Wait, they have to. How do they save an orphanage by robbing something?
No. They're the good guys. They shut down the bank robbers.
Oh!
They're the vigilantes.
I see. Okay. My bad.
They're like the guardian angels, but like not as stylish.
Okay. All right. Are there any women in this crew?
Yeah.
Okay.
For
like,
sure.
Like how many?
It's like three different white women. One of them is in a wheelchair and it's very inspiring.
Okay. All right. 2 points. Joey Devine, please pitch your Johnny Hecker television program.
I just have the title. I think it's self-explanatory. It's a travel show. It's called America's Best Fishing Holes.
3 points.
He really looks like he's like he could be in a holler in that picture.
He feels like there's a very like I was looking at it and I was like, this is like a real Tom Sawyer motherfucker. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
Like overalls. And his name, I will admit, originally I was leaning towards a show called Heck Klansman, mm-hmm. like with the 3 Ks, because he has the 2 Ks in his name.
Yeah.
But it's a real Tom Sawyer motherfucker. That's all I'm saying. He's whitewashing fences. He's stealing Indian gold. He's doing all those things. Fishing holes. America's best fishing holes.
Leaning on trees, playing the banjo.
Yeah.
Corbin, about the one thing about this guy that he's like most known for is being incredibly good on fake punts.
Uh-huh.
Like he just has a really good throwing arm. And like
he
like
does?
Even when the Rams had, he must have been like a high school quarterback or something. But
his arms are so undistinguished.
I mean, or he's just very good at fake punts because they just they survive them all the time. He was a starting quarter. He was like a Washington State champion as a high school quarterback.
Oh, I'm from Washington State.
Oh!
Yeah, where are you from? Anywhere near Bothell, Washington?
No, I'm not from Bothell.
Okay. Bothell. Okay. Yeah,
Bothell is up near Seattle there. A friend of mine is from Bothell, I believe. I believe Zach Nelson is.
Yeah. He's converted 2 fake punts in a single game, which is pretty crazy.
That's pretty baller. That's pretty boss.
Yeah.
All right, next. Defensive tackle for the New England Patriots. It's Malcolm Brown. We have Malcolm Brown.
Oh, man.
Got some dreadlocks. Fairly neutral expression, I'd say. A little sports yarmulke he's got going on here. I wouldn't say that there's a lot of interesting things to say about this fella. Beautiful eyes. Beautiful eyes, beautiful brown eyes. All right. 3, 2, 1. Joey Devine.
This guy has an incredibly sweet face.
Uh-huh.
And you can tell he's a little bit sad behind the eyes that he has to be part of the New England Patriots, uh-huh. America's greatest enemies uh-huh. currently, you know?
Yeah.
Like, so I think he has a... He's going to play a cop. An undercover cop who is investigating a drug ring inside of a middle school, so he has to pretend to be a middle schooler.
Wait, not a teacher?
No, no. He's playing a middle schooler, just a giant middle schooler.
So he weighs 330 pounds, and he's just got to do it.
Well, and here's how you explain that. They set him up with a fake white family that has adopted him, blindside style.
Oh.
Are they also all cops? Or
no, no, no. They're a church that they've tricked.
Oh, wait. So the family thinks that he's a middle schooler.
Yes. Okay. They're so racist and so into the blind side, they can't tell how old a black person is.
Uh-huh.
And he has to pretend like not to be able to read too.
Yeah. And the title of this show is, of course, it's just straight up Undercover. It's just called Undercover.
Okay. All right. I mean, I've heard better show titles, if I'm going to be honest with you. But
look, we can't all write puns at the blink of an eye like Sean Keane, yeah, especially when the guy's name is Malcolm Brown.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. That's fair.
Oh, no, it's called Malcolm in the Middle School. Sorry.
I was going to give you three anyway. Mostly just because I'm really fond of this fake family. But now I got to give you three. 3 points, Joey Devine. Sean Keane.
So this is actually a show based on the real Malcolm Brown. And what he does every week is try to just sort of like disrupt the culture of white supremacy that's in the New England Patriots organization. So every week he takes a different one of his Caucasian wide receiver or running back teammates to something like he goes to like a barber shop. He takes somebody to like the Essence Festival. He gets these white people and teaches them something about like the regular black experience, or like a book club where they're discussing the works of Toni Morrison. And it's just like one Edelman at a time. He's just trying to convert these guys to not even like they just have to be a little less racist. You know what I mean? They just got to be a little more open minded. And the show is called What Can Brown Do For You?
2 points.
Have I told my Julian Edelman story on this podcast before?
Please go right ahead.
I was a Postmate in Los Angeles for a long time, and I delivered food to Julian Edelman one time.
Is that what you guys call yourselves?
What? Well, the app is called Postmates, and it's like your Postmate has arrived.
Oh.
Do you want to hear the story about Julian Edelman, or do you want to argue app semantics?
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
But anyway, Julian Edelman ordered food at like 11 p.m. and the note on his order was "tip you if fast," which to me, if anyone should know how the value of speed is overrated, it should be a white wide receiver.
Ayo.
No.
But also, he called me chief 7 times in 30 seconds.
Did he seem like he was on uppers?
No. He seemed like he was on steroids, maybe, but not on uppers.
Okay. All right. That's it. I mean, I feel like chief, you know, that's real uppers behavior.
No, he was just like, it's real dick behavior, you know what I mean? Okay. It's like real above you behavior.
It's like, asshole.
Thanks a lot, chief. How you doing, chief?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like calling somebody boss.
I'm the most insufferable kind of player on the most insufferable imaginable team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, Julian Edelman has been suspended for steroids, by the way, Corbin.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, Come on, Julian, don't do that.
He missed the first month of this season, in fact.
How could he?
Yeah.
You guys think Brady does steroids?
Yeah, but he has his own, like, pharmaceutical company, the TB12 method.
I don't think any NFL player doesn't do steroids.
Oh, damn. All right.
I mean, they're just doing, like, whatever the 2019 equivalent of the clear is. I just don't think you can, like, recover that well.
The Scientology method, you mean?
What is like Tom Brady's philosophy?
Oh,
magic water? I mean, it is like a lot of pills. Russell Wilson sells like concussion water. There's a lot of
bad science.
Yeah, like
because these guys have short careers, so they're also
fucking brain damaged from the time they're like 8 years old.
Oh, yeah, I guess that's also true.
finally, we got some football nihilism on this episode.
I'm kind of curious if there are moments when they, like, sit down with the teams and they're like, these are the negative effects of steroids. This is what can do to you. This is the cancer risk. And then they finish and one guy raises his hand and is like, yeah, but is it worse than your brain melting from CTE? And then the guy's like, well, no. And they're like, because we're already all doing that every single day, and we have been for like 15 years. And then the guy's like, you know what, I'm just gonna give you guys some steroids. Actually, you turned it around.
He pulls out a thing and it rolls out and it's just a bunch of needles.
Yeah, he's like, you know what, you convinced me.
I will say CTE makes me think about things in a lot different ways, like because
you have CTE.
No. Like, the other day I was watching Jackass, and I was like,
oh, yeah.
Oh, no. All these guys have CTE.
Have you heard Knoxville speak lately?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Oof.
And then, like, even, like, thinking about, like, fictional characters, I'm like, oh, man, Batman for sure has CTE. You know what I mean?
Yeah. That's occurred to me, yeah.
Daredevil. Daredevil has CTE.
That's my theory about the television show Lost. Is that, you know, that ending that was like weird and creepy and didn't make sense to anybody? The reason is they're constantly getting knocked unconscious on that island. And after like 5 seasons, it's like none of that stuff was real. Like they've all survived plane crashes. Matthew Fox is knocked unconscious like every other episode. By the end, it's like, yeah, obviously I have to lie down on this beach because I'm the guardian of this island now. Someone's going to find him and they'll be like, wow, we x-rayed these brains. And yeah, ooh, they would think they were time traveling.
Next person. A guard for the New England Patriots. It is Joe Thuney. Got another redhead here. Big red beard, actually a little unnervingly like mine. Now I'm sitting here looking at it. Strong nose, blue eyes, little creases in his forehead. Little mole, you know. Sort of a tank feel here, it goes far to say. All right. Wait, who went second last time? I think Keane.
Sean.
Did. Yeah, Keane did.
Mm-hmm.
All right, ready? 3, 2, 1, Sean Keane, what is your television show pitch for Joe Thuney?
Okay, so this is a guy that he's a football player that essentially this is a comedic version of the Pat Tillman story. Where he's you know, he's playing for a successful team and he decides, like, you know what? Like, I hate ISIS. Like, I hate that we're pulling out of Syria. I'm going to enlist and I'm going to join him. But then it just becomes like stripes because they realize, like, he's good at football, but like he's too big for the army clothes and he's kind of bad at it. But they still send him to Syria anyway because there's such like a troop shortage. And it's essentially just like, it's very slapstick and it's a dark comedy where there's like a he's really doing his best, but all that, you know, he tries to disarm an IED, and he blows it up, and everyone, and he's got these like great plans that he's going to instill democracy, and then through a series of misunderstandings, actually just a traditional strongman takes over, despite his best intentions.
Wait, and is Joe like his chief of staff?
No, he's just like a he's almost like Army Zelig.
Uh-huh.
Oh. He's like marching through, and even though he has the best intentions, these misunderstandings that keep going through are just destroying the American war effort. You know, like he runs too far to the front of the line, and he ends up like accidentally destroying a mosque, and suddenly they hate it. They hate everybody there. And like there's another football hero who's in a battle, and Thuny accidentally frags him.
Uh-huh.
And and they keep covering it up, and he's like, Thuny, but he still like really believes in his mission, but he's actually like single-handedly destroying the course of the war the whole time, but he's still like held up. They keep flying him back to like get honored at NFL games.
Yeah.
And he actually gets to a point where he actually gets on a footstool for the anthems to be as far away from kneeling as he can. And the show's just called Friendly Fire.
Oh yeah. 3 points. I would actually watch that show. It wouldn't even need to be about Joe Thuny.
His name is Thuny, dude.
Thuny?
Yeah.
It is Thuny. Mm-hmm. I wrote Thurny.
Except you said Thuny first.
And I did.
And then you started saying Thurny. So I looked it up while Sean was talking.
Weird. All right.
Also, I think the Army would let him keep his beard, even though like everyone else is clean shaven, but they're he's a hero. He's
Joy Devine.
This guy looks like a football playing motherfucker, dude. I get why Sean went with like he's still a football player in his show. He's also gonna be a football player in my show. So Joe Thuny, he plays himself, but this is a fictionalized show. The Patriots win the Super Bowl. Joe Thuny gets really, really sick the day they're supposed to celebrate the parade. So he stays home. But the rest of the Patriots all drown in a duck boat incident when they're having their parade in Boston.
Uh-huh.
And he's the lone Patriot left. And league rules, it's never happened before, because never before has an entire football team been wiped out. Joe Thuny now has to be the quarterback of the New England Patriots. And they get a whole new team, but he has to play quarterback because he's the lone survivor left of the previous New England Patriots.
It's an obscure rule.
It's an obscure rule, exactly.
Uh-huh.
And he has to lead a ragtag team of scabs.
Mm-hmm. Is there also a strike going on?
Yeah, there's also a strike. Yeah, I didn't mean to say that, but yeah, there's also a strike. But again, that same rule, he has to play for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. He's not in the union. he has to
lead. He's just such a football playing motherfucker, you know.
Yeah.
He didn't get into this to do communism.
Yeah.
He has to lead the defending champion New England Patriots and coach and be the GM and quarterback, mm-hmm. by the way. I forgot to mention, because they're all dead, too. He has to defend the championship. And it is it's called Joe Survivor.
2 points.
Can I recommend two other titles, Joey? Well, the first one is Next Man Up.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And then the other one is All-Time Quarterback.
Next. From the Los Angeles Rams. A kicker. It's Greg Zierlein.
Oh, Greg the Leg, dude.
Do you know his nickname, Corbin?
Apparently, it's Greg the Leg.
It's Legzilla.
Oh.
Also, Legatron.
No, it's Legatron. I'm sorry.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Are there any other? Are there any like the Incredible Leg? Greg Legginson.
Legolas.
Yeah, Lego. Oh, I like that one. Anyway, so we got Greg the Leg here. We're talking 5 o'clock shadow. We're talking focused eyes. Hat not quite snug on his head. Seems like an intense fella, if I'm being totally honest here. Greg Zorlein. So I'm going to give you guys a second to think about it. Do a little stretching. Maybe look at my teapot here. All right. 3, 2, 1. Joey Devine.
All right. So Greg Zorlein. his character, I don't have a name for him yet. It's a 24 style real time season. He's just a guy, your regular old guy, attending a Brooks and Dunn concert. When he sniffs out, he's a vet, of course. He's just come home, certainly, you know, from two tours.
As everybody at a Brooks and Dunn concert has.
Mm-hmm.
Their concerts are actually 3 hours long because they have to go through everybody there. Mm-hmm. And be like, welcome back from the war, buddy.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So anyway, he's there. He's enjoying the Big and Rich or whatever, the opening band. And a cell of terrorists take the entire concert. But he had to go out to get some dip from his car. You know, his can of Skull. His mm-hmm. lucky can of Skull. From his car.
Does he when we're gonna have to pause for a second. Does he have one can that he just refills?
Cause yeah, it's like, okay. Exactly. Because right, okay. It's his lucky can. Yeah.
All right.
Look, in the final episode, he's gonna get shot in the chest.
Yeah.
But the lucky can is gonna stop the bullet, obviously.
Joey, I don't want to interrupt your pitch, but I think it would be cool if he was throughout the series, like re-upping his coal, like in a video game. You know, you find ammo that way, then mm-hmm. he, like, finds tobacco on one of the terrorists, and is like, ah, oh, I was almost out.
Are there a lot of scenes where the Skull can, he drops it, and he has to, you know, like, pick it up, and he goes to pick it up, and like, a bullet whizzes over his head?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
So anyway, he goes to his car. He sniffs out the terrorist. You know, they're holding Brooks and Dunn hostage. They're holding everybody hostage. 9 people are holding this like arena full of this arena concert hostage, and only one man can stop him, and it's Greg the Leg, dude. And it is called Eggsplosion.
Hmm. Oh boy.
God, I really fucked that one up too.
Oof. 1 point, Joey.
God damn it. The pitch was good. The pitch was good. The name was bad.
Yeah. I mean, though, especially this lucky can of Skull, frankly.
Yeah, I know. I had it down to the details, just didn't have the bow.
Yeah.
Couldn't get the bow on
that. Yeah, that title. Man, do you feel, do you worry that it's holding you back in the industry?
I meant to say Greg Explosive, too.
Oh, boy.
No, because I've had good titles on the things that I've made.
Okay, all right.
I'm just also trying to make jokes, you know?
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah. I'm not familiar with those so much, but...
They're not working, though, for me, so I should maybe stop.
Sean Keane.
Okay, so this guy, it's a very similar to his real character, Greg Zorlein, but after he's not as famous. He's just a great college place kicker who then went into appellate criminal defense. And what he does is he tries to exonerate criminals based on like re-looking into their cases. But what he uses are his skills from being such a good special teams guy. Like, he's like looking over the crime scene evidence, and he's like, this doesn't make sense. You know, the killer clearly was wearing a size 10 and a half cleat, while this guy who's here on death row was wearing like a size 9. And he like he analyzes like the chalk patterns that are found under people's feet and in the evidence. There's a point when someone's being tried for a terrorism charge, and he's like, wait a second. This guy was 110 feet away from this explosion when it happened. That's 38 yards. There's no way on a windy day that the pattern of the explosion would go in that direction. It would definitely hang somewhat to the left. Like there had to be a second terrorist, and he's constantly just exonerating these people, only using his place kicking and special team skills. And there's also generally a moment in every episode where he's arguing with some DA or a judge, and he just goes, "Quit moving the goalposts on me." Anyway, the show is called The Thin Zur Line.
A few problems. You're going to the he's a football player doing something else. Well, quite a bit, Keane.
Yeah, you're showing me pictures of football players, Joey. Okay. Corbin.
I'm not Joey. No, I'm joking. I would be honored to be Joey. And also, I think that this one's really running up against the edge of sense. I think it's going to have to be 1 point for that one, Sean Keane.
Well.
Next. A wide receiver for the New England Patriots. It's Chris Hogan.
Oh, God.
Oh, God. Oh, boy. Mm-hmm. I saw another picture of Hogan today that was unnerving. Let me see if I can track it down.
I do not like the way this man looks.
Ooh, what if I told you he played lacrosse at Penn State?
I know.
Yeah. That's why Bill Belichick, America's number one lacrosse fan. I feel like it's one of the most compelling reasons to believe that the Patriots are a white supremacist organization is that their coach is a huge lacrosse enthusiast.
Lacrosse is the deepest form of cultural appropriation.
Yeah, because it's a Native American game.
Yeah, it's like the Native American game, basically. Like, and now all we think about when we think about lacrosse are like the worst white people.
Yeah. Oh, Chris Hogan, boy, he's got. Did you see this other picture I sent? It's Chris Hogan, and he's picking up a kettlebell, and his muscles are going everywhere. And he's like looking forward, like he's looking at a sausage or something.
Mm-hmm.
And we're talking totally normal hair, maybe a mild psychopath vibe. I'm not here to say one way or the other.
Hey, don't give those kind of hints, dude.
I'm sorry.
Don't put ideas in Sean's head because that's where I was going, baby.
Well, I have a different path I'm taking. I think that Chris Hogan looks like he's had kind of a like a big scenario where he's like a child that wishes that he could be a grown up because of some kind of carnival machine. But also there's a haunted look to his eyes, his deep set eyes. The fact that he's like such a throwback guy. I think that he's like in the second stage of a big thing where he's actually a really old man who wished to be a child again and then was frustrated about being a child again and then wished to be like a 30-year-old man. And so I think it explains the fact that he looks like both ultra strong and ultra brittle, you know, like youthful and haunted. Like he's lived 100 lives, but he still needs to like get a life. You know what I mean? And he's like went from childhood, skipped puberty and went to adulthood, but also before that had like 35 depressed, sexless years as an adult. And so it's actually like kind of a harrowing psychological drama because when he's forced into this adult world where he's an executive at a toy company, he sometimes remembers like what it's like to be a child, and he's like, oh, I got the brain of a child, so I know what a child wants in this toy company. But equally, he has like the brain of an old man and the bitterness, and sometimes like the toy he will pitch will not be fun at all, and it'll actually be like very harmful and depressing, where he's like, yeah, this is like the divorced dad action hero, and kids like just on Christmas morning are just opening it and crying. And he's also deeply, heavily into prostitutes.
Yeah.
And it's just called Big Problems. Oof.
2 points. Joy Devine.
You're right. This guy's a fucking psychopath.
Thank you.
And on this show, he's definitely a psychopath. But there's also a very, like, bro-y, kind of like millennial Instagram-y vibe about him. You know what I mean? It's like...
Yeah, I see it.
Yeah. He plays... And look, serial killers are all the rage these days, right? And so are Firefest documentaries. So we are going to combine the two hottest things right now. It's a drama where the main character is a serial killer who only kills at music festivals and Instagrams his Instagrams the crime scenes.
Uh-huh.
And it's called Killapalooza.
Joy Devine, congratulations on your 3-point pitch.
Wow.
Thank you.
Brian Grazer is on the phone to discuss the production of Killapalooza.
Thank you.
Next is a quarterback for the New England Patriots.
Oh my God, dude. Do you want pitches based specifically on this picture?
Yeah.
This is a picture of Tom Brady in a white suit with a red tie.
No, you don't call that a red tie.
I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry. A picnic blanket tie.
Bow tie.
And it's not a very well tied bow tie.
No, it's very sloppy. And and he has a look on his face. I would go as far to call like the kind of smirk you make when you are shitting. And he has reflective sunglasses on, so you can't see how old and dead his eyes are.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, I'm going to give you guys a second to think about what this Tom Brady is going to be.
This Tom Brady looks so much different than any other picture I've ever seen of Tom Brady.
Okay. All right. You don't think, but you don't think it communicates his essential Tom Brady-ness though?
No, I don't.
I don't. It's something else.
Really?
Yes, really.
He's got like his button, like he's got his button done on the middle of his jacket, and it's kind of making a real V. All right. Anyway, okay.
I mean, he's also leaning over in a weird way in this picture to put
very
his arm around that guy. Yeah, he really does look slender.
All right. Well.
Also, his hair transplant looks very strange, the way he's combing his hair there.
But anyway, we're
pitching it based solely on this picture. So, friends, when you are reading my listeners, when you are hearing my pitch, I want you to not think of Tom Brady, but look up this picture. I don't know how Corbin found it.
I will put the pictures on the internet. Joy Devine.
Mm-hmm. This one's going to star Tom Brady and Bill Belichick, by the way.
Okay, go right ahead. Is Bill Belichick also dressed like this?
No, we'll get there. So Bill Belichick, we open on Bill Belichick is a crazy aging ventriloquist. And he has this dummy, and it's his favorite dummy, and he starts doing experiments on it. He gets struck by lightning. He's doing voodoo. He's doing everything to make his show bigger. And finally, one day, the doll, Tom Brady, comes to life. But then, as he comes to life, Tom Brady, Bill Belichick dies of a heart attack. So it's kind of an Edward Scissorhands situation, you know, where now this ventriloquist dummy played by Tom Brady has to learn how to live in a world without his father slash voice, except he can talk, obviously. And the show is called Throwing Voices.
Does he talk like a ventriloquist dummy?
Oh, yeah. He's like,
nah!
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's what his voice sounds like. But he has to go into town. He has to find a job. He goes on dates.
Do the dates go?
How do you think a date with a living ventriloquist dummy would go? Because he's what? He's what, like a foot and a half tall? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I guess that's fair. All right.
His arms barely move.
3 points, Joey. That's a wonderful
thank you.
You know, Sean Keane, let's hear it.
Well, I kind of imagine this as like a character who has a very similar arc to like a Tom Brady twin that ate Tom Brady in the womb and instead got into the high-priced savage world of underground croquet. And where, you know, normally it's a civilized sport, but in this dark underground of wealthy businessmen and croquet enthusiasts, there's no rules, and it's played as a blood sport. You're beaten with a mallet if you lose. The lucky ones are just put into indentured servitude, and at the top of the pile, wearing his signature all-white suits every time, having the power of life or death over the people in their mallets, hitting things around. It's him, Dom Brady. And, you know, ultimately, he's at the head of this empire. There's a resistance that starts in among the people that survive become indentured servants. And essentially, the arc of the show in the first year is whether people are going to come back under this. Are they going to be able to overthrow the oppressive regime at the top of the croquet thing? Or are they going to be just mercilessly pounded into the ground and, like, you know, nailed to the ground with wickets horribly and just pounded with the balls? Or are they going to be able to overthrow him? And the working title right now is TB 12 Years a Slave, but that doesn't seem right at all.
No.
But also his backup was a guy named Ryan Mallett. I think that might have been what I was thinking of as well.
You know, 2 points. I had to dock one for that title. That is a bad title.
Yeah, it wasn't a good title.
It's very late, Corbin. I understand.
It's been an hour and a half.
It has not been an hour and a half. I just want to say it's not been an hour and a half. Are there scenes where he turns around and you can see sort of blood on his white suit?
Well, that's what, like, throws him into a rage.
Oh, when the white suit gets dirty?
Yeah, like a grass stain, a fleck of blood, like a child's ice cream brushes against him.
Ooh.
Otherwise, he's totally cool and composed, but once something gets on the white suit, that's when the sunglasses come off.
Next.
I gotta say, looking at this picture still of Tom Brady that I've been staring at for the last 20 minutes, he also kind of looks like a man... Like if talented Mr. Ripley was like Mr. Ripley, the world's worst butler. It's kind of what he looks like. Anyway, Corbin,
are you gonna post a photo gallery along with this podcast?
Yeah. I think I'm gonna have to do that.
Entertainment.
Player with the Rams.
Akeem Talib.
Yeah, it's Akeem Talib. Anyway, here's a picture of Akeem Talib. He has a goatee, steely look in his eyes. He has a Broncos jersey on from Super Bowl 50. He's very bald.
I'm scared of him, but I trust him, you know? We'll give you guys a second to compose your Aqib Talib pitch. 3, 2, 1. Sean Keane.
So what Aqib Talib is most known for, I think, beyond being a cornerback, is chain snatching.
Mm-hmm.
He's done that, and he's provoked a lot of negative reactions.
You're going to have to explain chain snatching to me real quick.
Michael Crabtree wore a gold necklace around his neck, and Aqib Talib on multiple occasions, when lined up against him as a cornerback,
uh-huh,
grabbed the necklace and ripped it off his body
and threw it on the ground.
Yeah, and this is something that will often happen, famously in the hip hop community a lot. But it's just a sign of
he did it while they were playing sports against each other
several times.
I gotta ask, why doesn't everyone do this?
I mean, well, that's why you don't wear a gold chain onto the field.
Yeah, because
it seems
like the tactically right thing to do. Anyway, continue.
Right. And so what I imagine this show is about, because Aqib Talib clearly fears no man. He's a chaos agent. This is a show with Aqib Talib leading, and basically he does chain snatching, but he does it DSA style. What he tries to do is literally commando raid and overthrow chain stores to subvert things like that. The show's just called Chain Snatching, and it's it's him and Brandon Flowers, infiltrating a Walmart and changing all the prices and giving up DSA literature. And it's them, they occupy a Burger King and change everything to a vegan menu. And there's a lot of subversive stuff that goes on. Basically, it's just a lot of it's almost like
Newsbusters.
It would be like if Nathan For You was sponsored by Newsbusters, but also everybody was armed and also a really, really well-conditioned, strong athlete. And it's chain snatching. That's all they do. They're just trying to just destroy, put some chinks in the armor of
capital.
Of capitalism, basically.
Yeah. 2 points. Joey Devine.
This is going to be a reality show. 5 juvenile delinquents and Aqib Talib are sent to the forest to survive with nothing but pocket knives. He's got to teach them how to survive and teach them how to get on the straight and narrow. And also, maybe they'll teach him a little something about himself.
It's just a nice show. I mean, it's just a nice show.
He's like a great guy. Look at him. That guy is tough love for days, dude.
Yeah.
He for sure is going to put those youths on the straight and narrow. And also teach them how to snatch Michael Crabtree's chain.
Are there going to be bears, and is he going to snatch the bear's chain?
Oh, yeah, for sure, dude.
I mean,
it's a reality show. We're throwing snakes at him.
I mean,
we're doing all the Blair Witch tricks, dude.
He is kind of a really bad guy, though.
I'm basing these on the pictures.
Oh, he's a bad guy? He's a bad guy?
He beat up a cab driver. He fired a gun at his sister's boyfriend once.
I didn't know any of this. I don't follow football.
He fired a gun at his sister's boyfriend?
Yeah, I don't really know the circumstances.
Because that can go one way or another really aggressively. Beating up a cab driver, though, don't do that.
He might be from Texas, which I think maybe makes the gunplay a little loose. And now he's from Cleveland. Never mind. He went to high school in Texas. That's the reason.
2 points, Joey.
Thank you.
Next is a cornerback for the Patriots. It is Stephon Gilmore. We got I would say a jolly face looking fella. He's got some dreadlocks. He's got something sitting on the bridge of his nose, and he's I don't know, whistling or something in this one. Hard to say. I'm going to give you guys a second to think about this. 3, 2, 1. Joey Devine.
Stephon Gilmore plays a teacher from the inner city who's been sent to white suburbia mm-hmm. in a like in a flipped incident, you know, they sent all the white people to the inner city, all the like the rich white teachers to the inner city and like the tough black teachers to the it's like a court, you know, like the courts are doing it for whatever reason. We'll come up with
the law is arbitrary and we can mold it to our narrative purposes or whatever.
And he's got to teach all these privileged white kids. Oh, it's an all boys school too, by the way. how it really is, you know what I mean? But he's got and they teach him a little bit about like lacrosse or whatever. And it's called Gilmore Boys.
Yeah, 2 points. I mean, I knew it was going to be called Cap anyway. Keane.
this is a guy who's from the inner city. He lost his mom at a young age, and he's always had this dream of becoming a competitive hot air balloonist. And there are no black hot air balloonists, and so he's gotta make his way. No one believes in him. Except, you know, his aging coach, who was essentially what we're doing on this show is he's essentially white Bagger Vance, and this is a Kyle Chandler in old man makeup playing this role, and basically he's got to fight all the discrimination, like guys who are just like, you're nothing but ballast, we should toss you over outside the basket, and like. And then he's got to like
it's
he's got
to
deal with all these
thing to say to somebody.
I know. And then he's got to like lead the balloon, like just these degrading ways just to get balloon time. He's got to take all these like white couples who are trying to like propose over a vineyard, and they're real dismissive of him. But then when there's a hurricane there, he's the only one who can maneuver the hot air balloon out of the way and save the wedding, and they end up inviting him to the wedding, and he's slowly like climbing the ladder, but he's got a rival who's actually the heir to a Zeppelin fortune, and who's just trying to take him down. And over the course of the season, we're seeing him just rise up, and it comes down to one climactic hot air balloon race over the Grand Canyon, the most dangerous place to do hot air ballooning. He's just got to rise up thanks to Kyle Chandler, who dies of a heart attack right before that race across the Grand Canyon. It's devastating, but you know, it's him and the heir to the Zeppelin factor, and you just don't know who's going to take it in. There's a cliffhanger at the end, and it's literally a cliffhanger. Both balloons are snagged on a cliff. And, you know, what this one is called, it's actually a hot air balloon term. It's called steerage.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Shit, that's a good name for a show about hot air ballooning. 3 points, Keane. I mean, just a compelling program. Next, a quarterback for the Los Angeles Rams. It's Jared Goff.
In this picture,
I would say Jared Goff looks like he is 12 and he has an earpiece in. I'm going to give you guys a few seconds to think about it. All right. 3, 2, 1. Sean Keane.
All right. So this guy is a notable prep school miscreant. A lot of pranks. You know, he tends to give somebody's boat shoes a hot foot. A lot of pranks like that.
Is that where you shit in a shoe? Am I crazy? Or is that...
This guy would shit in a shoe for sure.
All right. No, but like, or is the hot foot where you put like
matches.
You light it on fire.
You light a fire.
I mean, it's actually pretty.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
It's because the foot gets hot, corpse.
Uh-huh. Oh, I see. I see.
Mm-hmm. And he's like, he's just known for like really, really pushing guys around. Like, you know, he's obviously he's on the crew team and he always like accidentally hits people with the oar and like he'll track someone down in the private sauna and, you know, he'll take not their lunch money, but their like, you know, Hampton's house rental money. And eventually, finally, the school's like, we're cracking down. We're getting rid of this guy. And he is sent to an outward bound style thing in Puerto Rico. And it's all kind of bullies like him. And they're sent to basically Teddy Roosevelt boot camp. They've got to like shoot a large animal.
Oh, okay.
They've got to charge.
I thought you meant
Santa
that this is like a boot camp that trained kids how to become Teddy Roosevelt.
Well, I mean, essentially that's the idea, but it's like you want to become a leader like Teddy Roosevelt, but you have to go through like Teddy Roosevelt things. Like you have to wear really thick glasses and you know, you gotta play football but without a forward pass. And what it does is it breaks these guys down and it teaches them the leadership skills they need to get out of this like scummy you know, mean prep school vibe they're in. And the show is called Bully for You.
Yeah, 3 points. I'm sorry, Joey. It was really good.
Yeah, I'm not worried about it.
Okay. Joey Devine.
So you guys know the Winklevoss twins?
Of course I do.
The guys who invented Facebook and had it stolen from them.
They invented Facebook, they would have invented Facebook.
Did you know they have a younger brother?
I did not.
On this television show they do, and uh-huh. He's played by Jared Goff.
Uh-huh, yeah.
And you know the genre, the horror genre of found footage?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
This is going to be America's first found footage comedy. Jared Goff plays the loser brother to the Winklevosses, whose entire goal is to be the world's oldest professional Fortnite player. Uh-huh. And it's told entirely through like Twitch footage and like YouTube vlogs and all the sad, shitty things that happened to him in his life. Because, I mean, fucking look at him. You know what I mean?
No, yeah.
And he's like, hey, what's up, YouTube? Today the bros wouldn't lend me any of the money they stole from Mark Zuckerberg. Stuff like that. And it is, of course, called Rip Van Winklevoss. I don't... Fuck! I keep fucking up the titles!
Well, Joey, I'm gonna give you 3 anyway. I mean, work on the title.
It's a good show.
Yeah,
a good show.
Mostly just because that would actually be a great show to watch.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Yeah, like, somebody should make that.
Corbin, will you send this episode to yourself via registered mail so this is all trademarked?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay.
No problem. I think if I give it to Wilms and then he sends it back to me, that'll... That's how that works.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that works.
Next is lineman, I think, for one sec, for a team. He's on the Patriots. It is Shaq Mason. We got Shaq Mason here. He's a African-American fella, patchy beard. He's wearing the number 69.
That's why you chose this, correct?
Yeah.
You looked up who wore 69 on one of these teams?
No, I didn't. I didn't. I looked up I looked up Shaquille Mason, and I saw he wore 69, and I was like, oh, eh. Fun.
Okay.
I think he looks a little depressed in this picture, if I'm being honest.
He looks very depressed in this picture.
Joey Devine, what do you got for me?
You know the show Billions?
Yes.
Kevin Durant's favorite show.
Stop. Is it really Kevin Durant's favorite show?
Yeah.
Yes.
He says it is.
Dude,
yeah.
Kev needs to stop being a wild parody of himself out here, man.
Come on, dude.
This is going to be like a show like Billions. Only instead of being about the high stakes world of rich assholes, it's about legal pot. And Shaq, what's his name?
Mason.
Shaq Mason. He actually plays the federal government trying to track down and finally catch the world's biggest pot. But, you know, in business terms, you know, it's not like a legal show. It's like a billion style show. It's all about business, the business of pot. And the sad guy's the cop.
Sad guy wearing the number 69. It's almost hard to see a sad guy wearing 69, you know?
Well, you're looking at it. You're making me look at it right now.
Yeah, that's fair. All right. 2 points, Joey. Sean Keane.
This is a suicidal football player. He sends a videotape explaining his actions to every member of the active roster, the entire practice squad, and most of the coaches. It's called 69 Reasons Why.
Really sitting right there.
Yeah, well, you know, slam dunk is still worth 2 points, you know. It's, three points. Hey, what do you, you know, what am I supposed to do? Next is a guy who plays on one of the teams. Oh, the Patriots. It's Landon Roberts.
This guy also looks sad, dude.
Yeah, he also looks, but he looks a little on the angrier side of sad, I think. He's got a tattoo. I think it says "Wide Me," or "Wide."
I don't think that's maybe, what it. Maybe it's, I don't think that's what it says.
It might say "Wide Meat."
I'm guessing it says "Judge Me." It's the bottom part of an "Only God Can Judge Me" tattoo. Would be my guess.
Oh, okay. Okay,
I think we're going to have to agree to disagree
on this one, but all right, Joe.
I think it might be something men.
Judge men?
Well, it's
shit.
Not judge,
that would be a fucking fucking badass tattoo, dude. It just says "Judge men," and it's like across your fucking chest.
We saw someone at Waterworld with an "Only God Can Judge Me" tattoo once.
Shit.
It's nice that you guys went to Waterworld with John Wilms.
And it was demonstrably false, Corbin.
Oh, because you were judging him?
Everyone was.
Everyone was.
And there are no gods at Waterworld.
All right, Sean Keane. 3, 2, 1.
Okay, I think this is a guy who looks like disturbingly intense to the point where he actually looks like he's a little bit brainwashed. And I think that we could have this guy in some kind of like Manchurian candidate scenario, but it's like much more mundane where they don't train him as an assassin, because like in 2019, that's like beyond anybody. All he's being trained to do is go work at a hedge fund and just make a bunch of trades that will like tank a company and everyone can like bet against it. And someone has there is like a heroic, you know, like SEC Securities Exchange Commission agent who's trying to stop him. But the main thing that triggers him is a sequence of events. It's so dumb. It's Clippy. The Microsoft Word assistant shows up, and that triggers his psychosis, and that tells him to like dump the stock and tank the financial market. And it's just called the MBA candidate.
I give you 3 because that sounds like a cool show. Like I would, you know. You can make like a really maybe slightly dumb prestige drama out of that, and I'd find it enjoyable.
I feel like it could be on Stars.
Yeah.
Like, not anything better than that, but it could almost be fake smart enough for that.
Joey Devine.
This is a game show.
Okay. Finally.
So this guy, right, he is clearly incredibly strong and also incredibly intense, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You get three contestants. It's based on the Three Little Pigs. He's called the Big Bad Wolf. You get three contestants. They have 15 minutes each to build a house.
Oh, fuck! Oh, fuck!
Then he's going to come out and destroy the house his bare hands.
Oh, fuck.
And whoever's house stands up the longest wins.
Oh, my God!
3 points.
Thank you.
It's just incredible to hear the Dream Factory at work, guys. next is a player for the Rams whose name is Sean Mannion. Here's a picture of him looking depressed.
Mm-hmm.
Very sad. He has sandy blonde hair. He's sad. He's so sad. And I don't know if I meant to pick a picture this sad, honestly.
What position does this guy
play? He's a backup quarterback, right?
Yeah, he's a backup quarterback. Yeah, yeah.
Who's is his dad the GM?
Okay. I think he went to Oregon State, and for some reason, if you started Oregon State for 2 years, you can be a backup quarterback in the NFL like indefinitely.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think part of it might literally be that there's fewer games on Saturday night, so a lot of people have seen them. He's from almost the same hometown as me. By the way, he's from Pleasanton, California.
He also has an unbelievable tan line in this picture.
Yeah, it's really insane. Crazy.
Anyway, please pitch your show with this.
This is a show on the PAX network.
Oh, no.
Or CNT, whatever the CMT is, you know, the country music channel or whatever that is. Hallmark, one of those. This guy can talk to the ghost of 9/11 victims.
Oh, boy.
And he has to go right their wrongs and say goodbye to their families. Because his wife died in 9/11. Because, I mean, fucking look at him. And he's got to go through all the ghosts and do all their things just so he can talk to his wife one last time.
Oh, wow. Does he get to fuck her, too?
No. This is a religious show, baby.
Oh.
You know, there's God and angels and bullshit, stuff.
Do they kiss?
Yeah. Yes, of course.
Okay. Are there like 5,000 episodes of this thing?
Yes. It's going to air forever.
Yeah, I guess that's fair. All right. 3 points, I guess. I mean, it was a good one. What am I supposed to do? I accidentally gave those points to Sean. Well, Sean, I hope you get 3.
Oh, shit. Done a lot of pressure now.
Yeah.
So this is basically a twist on the Marie Kondo Netflix show Tidying Up,
mm-hmm.
where people like find joy by like organizing their lives and stuff.
Wait, hold on. I don't mean to interrupt, but her name is Marie Kondo. I've only read it. I assumed it was Marie.
I had only read it, and then someone said it out loud this week.
Wait, really? It's not just Marie?
I mean, maybe someone punked me.
What the fuck?
I don't know. I wouldn't have said it like that, except I was corrected a couple days
ago. Oh, no, I'm not trying to correct you. I'm just, my mind is blown. Yeah. Her name is not Marie.
Yep, had no idea. I mean, I haven't watched the show. Why would
I? I mean, I think she's Japanese, right? And they say all the vowels, so there's no diphthongs in Japanese.
All right. Okay.
Am I using the term diphthong even right? I don't even know. But essentially, this is a guy where he is losing his things to be like tidied up, but no one has told him about it. So what's happening is that slowly every day, a stranger or a member of the production team removes one item from his house and everything else just remains exactly how it is. And it just goes on and on and on. And it's to see, like, will this simplify his life? Is it going to bring him joy? Or is it going to slowly destroy him as he thinks he's losing his mind by, like... Because first it's just like, oh, a pin's gone. I'm like, huh, what happened to that picture that was on the wall? And by the end, he's just down to, like, a bare-bones existence and has it's just, like, looking around, investing
like,
in a security...
Where's my damn refrigerator? Yeah.
And he's like, you know, how do you lose a remote? I have a one-bedroom apartment.
At no point does he start to...
Look at this guy. Do you think he would wonder about that?
No. Just like, I guess I lost that one too. Yeah, that was my favorite shirt. I guess the laundry lost it. And just like, how long can this guy, how long can we ride this out? And the title of this show is just Tidied. It's T-I-D-Y apostrophe D, like punked. Yeah.
Okay, 2 points. Mostly just because it makes very little sense. Last one. A tight end for the New England Patriots. It's Rob Gronkowski. Oh. You might actually someday be pitching things for this person.
I mean, we do know people who have worked on his existing television shows.
Yeah. Like this is this guy's next step in life. So... So, you know, you guys are going to have to put your all into this one. Sean Keane.
So,
pitch the Gronk.
I mean, I think like we're basing it on the picture, but I think this has just got to be Gronk. And so here's what I think happens. It's Rob Gronkowski and his three extremely gronked out brothers all living together. And they're all, you know, he's playing a fictionalized version of Rob Gronkowski. Like, the one on the show knows how to read. That's the main difference. But otherwise, it's like they've got this real frat house existence of, like, wet willies and wedgies. And suddenly they find out that there is a lost Gronkowski sister. Oh. And they invite her to live with them. And she's played by Rob Gronkowski in a wheel. Yeah, it's like a Jack and Jill situation. And it's just them. It's a classic, like, TGIF style thing where there's a lot of misunderstandings. They learn lessons, and Rob Gronkowski wins 5 consecutive People's Choice Awards. And it's just called Gronk and the She Gronk.
Sorry, it's called Gronk and the She Gronk.
Yeah, like the Hulk, Gronk and the She Gronk.
3 points. Joey Devine.
All right. Shark Tank's real popular, right?
Certainly.
These business shows are very popular. It's a reality show where we give Gronk $5 million to start whatever business he wants. And we just follow him for a year. We see what he spends his money on. But also it has to be something that makes something. So he has to, like, shop for a factory and hire people and not sexually harass the female job employees. And I just want to see what product Gronk thinks he could make.
Yeah. 2 points. That's it. Let's count up our final tallies.
Sean won.
No, I think you won.
Nope, you won, Sean. You have 34 to Joey's 32.
Wow. Yeah, I got 0 twice.
Oh, I forgot you had 0.
Yeah, Joey hit for power. You hit for average. But slow and steady.
I'm like Tony Gwynn, but alive.
In more ways than one. Yeah, all right, that's all. Congratulations to Sean Keane. Who do you guys think is going to win the Super Bowl?
The Patriots.
The Patriots.
Mm. Wow.
Nothing good ever happens.
Couldn't even make yourselves try not to say it, huh?
You know what's a weird thing, Corbin? I'm gonna share this fact with you. Do you know how many points the Patriots have scored in the first quarter of their Super Bowls combined.
So, is it 666?
It's three.
Fuck.
Isn't that fucking weird?
Oh, I hate it so much. I hate it so much.
I should have an article about the Patriots and the Daily Beast today or tomorrow, by the way.
It's how many is that now?
Two.
You're making more money off this Super Bowl than Maroon 5, baby.
Awoo. and honestly, this thing I wrote for the Daily Beast, it's incredibly mean.
Hell yeah, dude.
Yeah.
Fire.
Fuck them. I loathe the fucking Patriots. You guys have anything to promote? Round Ball Rock?
Yeah, we put out an album of Slam Dups.
Get those. It's good as hell. If you do, yeah. If you somehow don't already listen to Round Ball Rock and would like something to prime you into listening to Round Ball Rock, go to bandcamp.com/roundballrock.
It's the other way around. It's roundballrock.bandcamp.com. Pardon me. It's available for pay whatever you want. Yeah. So that includes free.
Yeah. Get those, listen to them, and it will give you a very, it will give you a very present idea of what you get when you listen to Round Ball Rock, which is, as I've said on here before, my favorite basketball podcast.
Oh, thanks, man. Corpse. Thanks, man.
Although this new Blazers podcast is running up the charts. I was on it this last week. We already had Clyde. It's a Blazers podcast, but everybody on it is mean and they hate the Blazers. I love it.
That sounds good.
With the Seth Johnston and the Brandon. So thanks for joining me, guys.
Thank you, Corpse.
Well, thanks for having us.
Thank you to the audience for listening, and everybody have a wonderful day.
We're back.
Oh, God.